Welcome back to this special session of this international seminar. ये एक मुबारक मौका है कि पीर शाह अबू बकर सिद्दीक मेमोरियल सेमिनार के मौके पे हम यहाँ पे जमा हुए हैं. इस सेशन में हमारे साथ प्रोफेसर टॉनी स्टीवर्ट हैं, वो इज़ वन ऑफ द फाइनेस्ट स्कॉलर्स ऑफ रिलीजन्स एंड लिटरेचर्स इन द बंगाल मिल्यू for several centuries, covering the period. He is Gertrude Conway Vanderbilt Chair in Humanities, Professor and Chair, Vanderbilt University Department of Religious Studies. He will be speaking on the hermeneutics of religious biographies, the life and legacy of Pir Shah Abu Bakr Siddiqui. Professor Tony Stewart.
Assalamu alaikum. I'd like to take a second to thank Allama Pir Saif Uddin Siddiqui, who made this possible, Syed Muhammad Bahauddin, whose work I depended on very much in understanding the life, and Professor Amit Day, of course, who was behind the organization. Vanderbilt University te ami moddo juger bangla shahito dormo itadi shikachi shejone amar adunik bangla bhalonoy. So if you'll forgive me, ami ingrijite bolbo. As one who works in the 14th to 17th centuries, I do not always enjoy the incredible narrative and material historical documentation that we have for the life of Pir Shah Abu Bakr Siddiqui. Working with much more ephemeral materials has, however, forced me to develop models for understanding religious biography, specifically the lives of saints, and this is what Amit had requested me to speak on. It is not enough simply to know what is reported about a saint, but we need to know how we know what we know. A rigorous understanding of the source material we attempt to interpret. The configuration of religious biography will help us to better understand and celebrate the life and accomplishments of Pir Shah Abu Bakr Siddiqui. Sometime late in the 18th century, in the southern Rar district of what you now call West Bengal, a poet named Foyjula composed a popular tale in the performance genre called Panchali. After paying his respects to Niranjan, Muhammad, and the Pak Panjaton, among others, he mentions two early peers well known in Bengal, Borokhan Murid Mia and Ismail Gaji. I wish to use the narrative of the latter, Ismail Gaji, as a way to pry open some of the interpretive problems of hagiography or the life of the saint. The Risalat Ushahara was composed by Pir Muhammad Shatardi, who visited the tomb of Ismail Gaji and heard his story there. He completed his text in 1042 or 1633 of the Common Era. He reported that Ismail Gaji was born in Mecca as a member of the Quraysh, claiming direct alignment with the Prophet. But as a young man, he is said to have encountered the Quranic passages that promise paradise for martyrs of the faith, and swayed by that romance, sought the military life out of that desire. He traveled east, landing in Lucknowati during the reign of Rukn-ud-Din Barbak Shah, and he ingratiated himself to the king by becoming a valued advisor. Eventually, and there are three episodes here, eventually the king sent him to fight a minor unnamed Gajapati ruler of Orissa, the Raja of Mondaron, whom he beheaded after overrunning his heavily fortified outpost with a small contingent of 120 men. A few years later, Ismail Gaji led a force against Komeshore, a ruler of Kamrup. He miraculously survived his first battle, Even though he was routed, he regrouped and was rebuffed a second time, but the text says that that evening, Ismail Gaji, in disguise, rode directly into the enemy camp, slipped into the sleeping quarters of the king and queen, where he tied their hair together and placed a sword across the king's chest. Commissure and his guards feared this was the work of a malevolent spirit, but after several repetitions of the act, the king eventually spotted a hoof print and concluded it must be Ismail Gaji. So in fear, he brokered a peace. He then submitted to Ismail Gaji, sealing his capitulation by the ritual acceptance of chewed pan. In the third episode, the final episode of the Risalat ush-Shahada, it narrates the jealousy of Bahandoshi Rai, for whom Ismail Gaji had built a fort in the frontier garrison of Ghoragat. Bahandoshi Rai was jealous of Ismail Gaji and the favor that he enjoyed from the king, so he secretly sent word to Barbak Shah that the latter was conspiring with Kameshwar, his former enemy of Kamrup, to overthrow Barbak. No doubt wary of Ismail Gaji's competence, Barbak forced the Gaji to return where, the text reports, he was beheaded by Sultan Barbak on the 14th of January, 1474. Only when the head of Ismail Gaji was presented to Barbak did the latter learn how he had been duped, and he reportedly wept and openly repented of his rash actions. In his grief, he promised to bury Ismail's head in the family vault. But the Gaji's animated head instructed Barbak to bury it at Kantaduar. Barbak did what I suspect everyone in this room would do if a head was talking to you, sans body, consented, and a garrison of soldiers was set out with the Gaji's head, which miraculously continued to fight all along the way. Every place the convoy stopped, a darga mysteriously arose until they eventually reached Kantaduar, where the head was interred. The body, however, was laid to rest in Mondaram, both places being visited by Barbak Shah, who left considerable gifts for the tomb's maintenance. Now, in editing and translating the manuscript, the 19th century Orientalist G.H. Dumont wrote that there are four shrines dedicated to Ismail Gaji, even though actually there are five. The head was buried, he names five. The head was buried at Kantaduar in Pirganj, with another darga close by in Jola Mokam. His body was buried at Mondaram, and his miracle-working staff was interred in a darga 20 miles south of Rangpur. He also notes that there is a final spot situated on an island in the middle of a large lake called Borovila, although the author could see no physical structure of a darga. Now, Sultanate and Mughal historian Abdul Karim indicates in his article on Shah Ismail Gaji that there are actually six dargas, one for his head, one for his torso, and one for each of his four limbs. Karim goes on to cite Abdul Latif's Persian diary, which predates the Risalat ush-Shahada, and which presents conflicting dates for the events, placing Ismail Gaji in the reign of Hussein Shah about a quarter century later. Since both writers of these Persian documents were more or less contemporaries and each live more than 100 years after Ismail Gaji, Karim concludes that it is impossible to tell who was correct, an academic version of the standard disclaimer that only God knows for sure. Dumont also reported a popular oral version of Ismail Gaji's story collected by the Orientalist Blachman and published in 1870 that was consistent with that of the Risalat ush-Shahada, but which substituted Hussein Shah for Barbak Shah, though he notes with characteristic Orientalist disdain, and I quote here, "It must be remembered that Bengalis almost invariably attribute any important event of which they do not know the date to the time of that king, for he is the only king who is still remembered by name among the people." Considerably later, Gurindranath Das, the late 20th century Bengali ethnographer and collector of the tales and legends of Pirs, and incidentally who also profiled Pir Shah Abu Bakr Siddiqui, argues that Ismail Gaji was an itinerant mendicant Sufi in the region. Without citing his sources, he writes, and I'm translating here directly from the text, Pir Ismail Gaji was a warrior for the faith. There are two dargahs dedicated to this pir, one in Mandaran and the other in Pir Ganj in Rangpur district. His severed head was buried in Pir Ganj while his decapitated body was entombed in Mandaran. Ismail Pir had traveled to many different regions in order to spread the religion of Islam. But when he came to Gorumandaran, he was greeted with no small hostility. The ruler of Gorumandaran was a certain Hindu who stiffly resisted the efforts to spread the faith. So he interfered with the religious practice of Ismail Pir. As a result, the pir clashed with the ruler. A short while into the confrontation, the head of Ismail Gaji was sent flying off his body. Even though his head was separated from his torso, he continued to fight for some time. When the news reached ruler Hussein Shah, overlord of Ghor, the latter summoned Ismail Gaji's body to his presence, and there he paid obeisance to that body sans head. The headless body of Ismail Gaji then mounted a steed and returned to Mandaran. End of quote. Now again, without any kind of attribution, Das notes that historian Rakhaldas Bandopadhyay attempted to historicize the account, speculating that Ismail Gaji must have followed in the wake of Hussein Shah as the latter's army sought to take control of Kamrup. Apparently, based on an inscription that mentions Hussein Shah at the dargah of Ismail Gaji at Ghordaghat, although mysteriously that inscription has disappeared. The shift in tenor of Ismail Gaji's story from the two earlier Sufi sources to the latter reportage of 19th and 20th century historians, I think, is instructive. With no eyewitnesses, it moves almost imperceptibly from two laudatory and somewhat predictable normative accounts in the 16th and early 17th centuries that had already begun to expand the narrative of Ismail Gaji to include an association with two of the most famous rulers of pre-modern Bengal, Barbak Shah in the version of Muhammad Shatardi and Hussein Shah in the version of Abdul Latif. And then a popular confirmation that seems to conflate the two, that is the story reported by Blockman. The tale is then documented with textual translation and field work to produce a historicist or positivist scientific reading by the 19th century Orientalist, Damont, who leaves the commentary on the fantastic events simply hanging without comment, but with a clearly communicated derisive attitude toward the native imagination. By the 20th century, the tale is demythologized, deliberately separating the mythical elements from the solid facts of history, as it's often referred to, and interpreted to mean that Ismail Gaji must have followed behind the pacification of the region by Hussein Shah. This is the Bandopadhyay version, a reading that is ironically purely speculative, entirely beyond anything even remotely resembling facts. Finally, the tale is totally dehistoricized, streamlined to its bare mythological contours, and repurposed to contemporary political terms of starkly demarcated Hindu-Muslim antagonism with little nuance, little subtlety. This is the Gurindranath Das version. A narrative that portrays Ismail Gaji's body rather than his head continuing to fight. Now the recording of the miraculous in these tales signals a shift in perspective that begins with a relatively value-free reporting of events with no semblance of rejection of the narrative as unbelievable to a skeptical and even derisive rejection and dismissal which ultimately resolves into baseless speculation on what might have been the series of events. Finally, we get a recapitulation of the events in completely different modern political terms. In the retelling, each author seems to hesitate at some point, which suggests that underlying the reportage, there is an earnest question of historical verity. Could it have really happened, seems to be the question. In processing the exploits of the headless warrior Ismail Gaji, that question of possibility ultimately reveals a reporting perspective that moves deliberately from a non-committal suspension of belief or even acceptance to one that posits a breach, a dichotomous relationship between what can be positively identified as myth or legend and what can be identified as history. As the reports move closer to the present, the dichotomy is more and more starkly demarcated, until which point the miraculous is defined in scientific or positivist terms. The miraculous is myth and is understood to be a patent falsehood, while the history is valued as an uncontested fact. In these reports, that which is deemed historical is taken to be self-evident and transparent, but that self-evidentiary nature depends in turn on little more than an assumption of plausibility. That is, the item in question does not violate the laws of nature in as much as the author can tell, and they depend on rational choice to determine what's true and what's not. Any standard of verification through corroboration is generally absent, especially in the case of Rakhaldash Bandopadhyay's determination of what must have been. The point now is not to criticize the prior scholarship, for they, just as we today are victims of the intellectual currents in which we operate, but I want to use this as a way of identifying why these tales present so much difficulty to current interpreters. But it should likewise serve as a cautionary exercise for those who seek to eliminate any suggestion of the miraculous or inexplicable power exercised by a Sufi saint, whether it's Karamat or Baraka, the more generalized display, is to downplay the devotional mode and even pious hyperbole that might engender as a result, for they are an integral part of the saint's narrative. The question of historical veracity, did these things actually happen, seems to drive a wedge into the narrative by dividing it between myth, in the popular sense of the term of falsehood or counter to fact, and history, the stories as retold and analyzed, but do not actually draw firm conclusions. To categorize the fantastic bits as non-history or untruth, modern interpreters have, in effect, violently split the narrative to construct two separate texts without analyzing the coherence of the narrative qua narrative. They cede the miraculous or inexplicable to alternate genres such as folk literature, mythology, popular legend, and so forth. Categorizing, that is, redefining the genre in order to dismiss or eliminate, relegating what they deem to be legendary or mythic material to a genre outside their declared purview, which allows them to ignore any story that presents difficulties for their historicist interest, but by what means and what measure they never state. What these scholars have done, however, is to miss and misread the nature of the text. They fail to recognize the special features of the narrative itself. We need to recognize that the authors themselves and the community that received and circulated these tales made no such distinction of historical truth and untruth of myth. So the interpretive act commits a special kind of violence on its material, both ideologically and doctrinally, which removes what is often most important, the expression of devotion, which is central to any hagiographical account. These interpreters seem to have missed the obvious facts that the narratives demonstrate a rigorous coherence, that the narratives themselves have histories, and that their histories are rooted in and expressive of the sentiments of identifiable communities who circulate and perform these texts. So a hagiographical text, I argue, is not just about its narrative content, it's also a statement of devotion. These narratives are conveyed and interpreted with the historical and fictional elements intertwined, intertwined in such a way that belies the utility of bifurcation. Every story of a Sufi peer is telling the story of one of the friends of God, one whose presence invariably exudes charisma and piety. That makes the narrative a hagiography, not a biography. Whether corroboration marks the subject as historical or if the subject is wholly fictional. The characteristic and devotional tales, the charismatic and devotional tales, you have to forgive me, I'm having trouble reading with this light. Let me start that again. The charismatic and devotional tales of the Pirs and Piranis are not histories or biographies, they are religious biographies, a genre that has its own unique characteristics, features that have troubled Western interpreters of these tales for centuries. Now, in the early 1970s, Frank Reynolds and Donald Capps in the biographical process made a significant move to break the crude myth-history distinction that had paralyzed the study of religion or sacred biography generally. In place of the category of hagiographical history, they proposed the bios or the life of the individual without requiring that life to be about dates, about history, about anything other than its story. Rather, the bios could be constituted by psychological experience or social roles, to name only two alternatives to the more reductive notions. The bios was the sequence of events that gave shape to the life narrative. In place of myth, in that old myth-history bifurcation, they argued for the much more complex religious ideal, which was the visionary shape of the perfect religious figure whose life was shaped by and in turn shaped the theological truth and doctrinal directives. They proposed that the religious ideal condition the form of the life, the bios, and the two in their combination produced what they termed a biographical image. Reynolds and Capps' idea of the biographical image had the added advantage of allowing scholars to better differentiate the normative genres that make up the broad category of religious hagiography or biography. When religious biography functions to articulate or create a new religious ideal, it marks the subgenre that is the lives of founders and saviors. When religious biography is composed to exemplify a pre-existing religious ideal, it gives rise to hagiography or the lives of saints when it's composed about someone, or it's confessional when it's autobiographical. Function here defines genre and expectation. In contrast to the production of religious biography from within the tradition, any non-normative approach was deemed to be critical biography. critical biography uses hagiography and sacred biography as source material. So the ones on the right use the material from the ones on the left of this graph. Perspectives generated from the various disciplines of history, psychology, anthropology, text criticism, semiotics, and so forth. That is, it participates in multiple discourses. Critical biography shares with both sacred biography and hagiography the way the religious ideal conditions the bios to construct the biographical image. And in this sense, critical biography does mirror religious biography, but with different narratives and interpretive strategies. On both sides of this genre distinction, it is always the religious ideal that dominates. The bios is often little more than an excuse, a framework on which to hang the preferred normative religious ideal. And as I've argued elsewhere, the religious ideal takes center stage as the real subject of hagiography or religious biography, displacing the stated object of study, the story of the religious individual. The bios, the individual, becomes the ostensible subject, while the real message remains the religious ideal. For critical biography, then, the choice of disciplined approach dictates the handling of the religious ideal. In one direction, the focus is on demythologizing the individual. That's in the upper right-hand corner of the graph. Accounting for or removing altogether the conditioning role of the religious ideal in order to produce a diachronic narrative. That is, to rationalize it through a contemporary mode of historical interpretation and the oft-stated removal of pious hyperbole to focus on the social history that produced the conditions necessary for the figure to gain ascendancy, or to focus on the psychological factors that contributed to the figure's experience. More synthetic studies, of course, often combine several of these approaches. This mode captures what generally is called the life and times of the figure. Tending in the opposite direction, critical biography can choose to examine the ways in which the message conveyed by the life of the figure can be read, interpreting the semiotics of the image, which points to the message, which is ultimately resolvable into theology at its most creative form, or more into doctrine in its more pragmatic or applied form. At the extreme end of the semiotic analysis of critical biography, the life disappears altogether, and the symbolic representations and or the message itself are all that is left. A theological perspective that is depicted synchronically as a system rather than as the product of a historical development. For critical biography, the treatment of the religious ideal dictates the final production, either in an attempt to eliminate it or to account for it to explain its meaning. This mode captures, as we see in the lower right-hand side, the life and teachings. If we return to the tales of Ismail Gaji, we can plot the six reports. The original recorders writing in Persian imply acceptance, so it's in the upper left-hand quadrant, but suspend judgment regarding the miracles, Abdul Latif and Shatari, both of whose texts would then rigidly fall on the normative side, that is the side of religious conviction of reporting the hagiography. The Orientalist casts skepticism on the guise of reporting the native accounts, Dumont, invoking a non-normative standard for evaluation and therefore falling on the side of critical biography in the upper right-hand corner. Dumont clearly leans in the direction of demythologizing the life by purging it of its miraculous events, or the tales are retold as evidence of the naive credulity of the native intelligence, Blockman, to the same end as Dumont, only more forcefully. Alternately, the stories are dismissed nearly in toto, that is, demythologized altogether in favor of an entirely made-up story which replaces the original report, which is Bandopadhyay's version. And finally, one scholar, Gurindranath Das, retranslates or reconfigures the tales into narratives of modern Hindu-Muslim conflict according to contemporary categories of sectarian strife, reconfiguring the action into a 20th century life and times, decontextualizing it historically, and then recontextualizing it ideologically, perpetrating perhaps the most violent relocation of material. When pushed to the limits, the impulse of one is to try to get at the real history, the hagiographical image denuded of its religious ideal, or the other end, to get at the real message, the bios itself dismissed in favor of the religious ideal. But in Diltai's terms, these portrayals are always going to depict a pattern which reflects the values of the authors and audiences. And in spite of their differences, the pattern for each of these accounts is the Sufi warrior saint, the Gaji. While demythologization futilely attempts to eliminate all the so-called accretions to the historical figure, the normative deployment of the biographical image has been quite the opposite. In many instances, the life can become so malleable, so flexible, that the historical bios nearly disappears altogether, or is so completely rewritten that it becomes unrecognizable. The life often becomes becomes a little more than a fiction in service of a message, a teaching, a theology, an ideal. And so it is with the subject of our celebration today, Pir Shah Abu Bakr Siddiqui. If we look, we see in the lower left-hand corner, we found or create as a creator or a savior In the upper left-hand corner, the saint will develop and refine the message. In the upper right-hand corner, the scholar will demythologize and contextualize or eliminate some of the message in order to get at the bios. And the opposite in the lower right-hand corner, where the bios disappears in favor of the religious message, which is to redefine and interpret what has been said. And we will see all of these at work in the presentation of the life of Pir Abu Bakr Siddiqui that follow. In its telling, the early life of Pir Shah Abu Bakr Siddiqui assumes the contours of a typical romance, a quest narrative, understandably consistent with hero tales nearly everywhere. He received a call to adventure, a dream which led him to study Farsi, Arabic, and Urdu in addition to his English and Bangla, then after training in local madrasas to make the pilgrimage to Mecca. This period of study in Mecca and Medina was a period, as we've already heard this morning, this was a period of transformation that reshaped his outlook and led to his personal mission. He would bring back to Bengal a message that would transform the Muslimani landscape. Reform was his mission, and the linchpin was education. Unlike Ismail Gaji, who was a mendicant and a warrior, a celibate who was essentially life-renouncing, seeking martyrdom, Abu Bakr Siddiqui was a life-affirming saint who sought to transform society through peaceful means and education. This activity, however, soon became his identity, I would argue, in a manner that's consistent with hagiography worldwide. And his bios was gradually subsumed by the activity of furthering his religious ideal, which became his real subject. His work was to transform the personal conduct of Muslims in Bengal, which he began by his own example. He modeled his life on that of Muhammad, the Imitatio Muhammadi. But adapting to a modern age where foreigners control the economic and political landscape, as never before, he presciently saw that the model of his own conduct was insufficient without education. But education had to be accessible, which meant the old way of teaching through Farsi and Arabic had to yield to Bangla if it was to reach his wider audience. So he campaigned successfully to modify and expand the curriculum of the madrasa, of which, by some counts, he established an astonishing 800 in number and another 1,000 masjids. And the topics of education could not be limited to the traditional study of the Quran, tafsir, or exegesis, or hadith. He promoted a modern education with the new sciences included so that Muslims would find a place in the new emerging polity that was India. Vernacularization was not just for the curriculum, but for public discourse as well. So he patronized Muslim Bangla journals, participated in learned societies, and even had a hand, as we have already heard, in establishing several colleges. As a result, his systematic efforts to educate in the vernacular Bangla enabled him, in the long run, to play a major role in the reform of Muslim society in Bengal, a Sharia-based Sufism. He has been called a truly modern reformer, and he is. But a closer look at his accomplishments suggests that his were in effect the very same strategies as many of the traditional Sufi sheikhs of old. They were simply placed in a new garb and mediated through new forms. Rather than a single kanka to attract the followers to his presence, he himself moved from district to district, though he cultivated Furfura Sharif as a central point. His primary writings were modern variants of the traditional maktubat, treatises and teachings, and isharat, clarification and guidance, while his followers' writings documented his deeds, creating new forms of tazkira and malfuzat, that is, hagiography and sacred biography. To approach him devotionally has the power to change an individual's life. To approach him intellectually is to reveal the basis for modern Muslim reform. What was truly different was the way his adoption of Bangla helped to create a political awareness and a sense of Bangla Muslim identity, utilizing the new institutional structures and technologies of the colonial world. He was not alone in these endeavors, but the contribution of Pir Shah Abu Bakr Siddiqui certainly transformed the Bengali Muslim landscape. Thank you.